Today, we're talking about gene therapy for neurologic disease. I'll tell you a little bit about our work in a specific model of neurologic disease. I think all of us know someone or several people with a severe neurodegenerative disease of some sort. My own father-in-law died of Alzheimer's disease, which was a despicable experience for him and the entire family. Of course, President Reagan had Alzheimer's disease as well. Michael J. Fox still battling Parkinson's disease. And this fella is named Lou Gehrig, who died of ALS. I learned recently that he still holds the major league record for the most number of Grand Slam home runs, one of the greatest baseball players ever to live, and died of this severe neurodegenerative disease called now Lou Gehrig's disease. In the US, some of the most prevalent neurologic diseases are listed here. Globally, roughly 1 out of every 10 lost years of health are due to neurologic diseases. To treat dementia alone across the world, we're spending about $604 billion a year, which is estimated to be about 1% of the gross domestic product of the world. And economic output losses, meaning lost productivity due to neurologic diseases, are estimated to be about $8.5 trillion annually, and that should double by the year 2030 if we continue on the same trajectory. All of these diseases are, most of these diseases anyway, are multifactorial, meaning that one or several genes can be involved, or an interaction between genes and the environment can be involved. So they're a little bit tricky to treat by gene therapy with the idea of replacing a single gene to make an effect on the disease progression. We study a group of disorders called storage diseases, which are monogenic diseases, single gene disorders. We know the specific gene in almost all of these 50 disorders that are defective, and if we can replace that gene with a functional gene, we think that we'll be able to do some good for these diseases. On the whole, this group of 50 diseases is about as common as cystic fibrosis and hemophilia, diseases that are more common that most of us probably have heard of. Two-thirds of the storage diseases affect the brain, making them the most common neurodegenerative disorders of childhood. So while you may not have heard of many of the individual diseases, such as Tay-Sachs disease, Sandhoff disease, GM1 gangliosidosis, the entire class of disorders is quite common and quite a burden for those who have been affected by them. Now, this subset of diseases that we study, gangliosidoses, can be found in animals, cats, and sheep. Unfortunately, they're also found in children. This little fella is Porter Heatherly, lives in Opelika with his parents, Sarah and Michael. He was diagnosed with GM1 gangliosidosis. This picture was taken not long after Porter was diagnosed. This is Porter today, actually a few months ago when he came to visit us at the vet school. This is how these kids spend the majority of their lives, in a reclining stroller like this, barely interactive with the world around them. Their parents think that they can pick up on some responsiveness, but really, to you and me, they would be non-responsive. These are Porter's parents. This is Henry Baker. All three of these, actually his wife Trudy, all four of those people are Auburn graduates. And we hope that we'll be able to do something to make an impact on these diseases very soon. Henry and Trudy actually discovered the cat models in the late 1960s, early 1970s, and soldiered on and on for many years characterizing the diseases so that we could get to the point of actually treating them someday. I think we're there right now. This is the Tay-Sachs disease timeline. Tay-Sachs disease was first described in 1881 by Warren Tay and Bernard Sachs, hence the name Tay-Sachs disease. The first animal model of a storage disease was described by Dr. Baker in 1971. The reason I put the timeline up is to say that in the 135 years since these diseases were first reported, the most effective medical intervention for these kids has been insertion of a stomach tube so that they can be fed a liquid diet, directly into their stomach, and they don't choke on food taken orally. The cause of death primarily for kids until the stomach tubes were beginning to be inserted was aspiration pneumonia. Now their lives have been expanded or extended 1 to 2 years with the insertion of a stomach tube. Average lifespan is 2 to 5 years. Terrible, awful, miserable diseases that need to be eradicated from the face of the earth. You can think of them a little bit like early onset forms of Alzheimer's disease or early onset forms of diseases that occur later in life because the same degenerative process occurs. All right, so what are we going to do? We don't have a treatment today. What are we going to do? Gene therapy is on the horizon. I think we're almost there. This is an image of a typical gene therapy vector. The reason that I put it up there is to show you that the only part of the native genome, the only part of the native genetic material of this naturally occurring virus are these two black rectangles on either end of the vector. Vast majority of the native complement of genetic material has been removed and replaced with beneficial genes to help treat the disease. We can treat the cats by one of two ways. By far the most experience that we've had is by direct intracranial injection of the brain. It's a 90-minute surgery one time. The cats wake up 2 hours, they're fully alert 2 hours after surgery, and are returned to their mamas by the end of the day. 98% of the cats that have been treated this way never look back. We have very few complications. It's amazingly safe procedure in the cats, and actually humans have this type of procedure as well. This is an image of a cat brain, and for the sake of time, I'm not going to go through all the details, but basically what we're looking at here is a cat brain that's been divided from front, the frontal pole right here, all the way to the back, the cerebellum right here, spinal cord as well. Anywhere that you see blue staining is evidence of the therapeutic enzyme that we're trying to replace in these cats. This is normal level of that therapeutic enzyme. In an untreated cat, there's a little residual staining, but not very much. Same thing for the spinal cord. From the front of the brain all the way through the cerebellum and throughout most of the spinal cord, we see dramatic restoration of enzymatic activity after a single surgery, again, that lasts 90 minutes. All right, for the sake of time, I'm not going to go over the survival curves and the clinical rating scores. We'll just talk about the effect on ambulation. This is an untreated cat at 6.5 months, approaching 7 months. You can see that he has balance difficulties, has trouble standing up, has fine tremors, and this will progress to the inability to stand up, which is our humane endpoint, the point at which the animals are euthanized. It's important for me to say, because I'm a cat lover and I know there are many here, we don't find any evidence of pain in this neurodegenerative process. They don't vocalize a lot. They don't rub their heads against the cage. They don't pant when they breathe. They're just frustrated because they can't do the things normal cats can do. Compare that to a treated cat at almost 5 years of age, and I think if I put that cat in a group of 10 normal cats, it would be hard to pick him out. This fella is named Omari. He's now over 7 years old. He looks no different from this video taken at 5 years of age. He shows, knock on wood, he shows no signs of slowing down. And the average survival of these cats that have been treated by intracranial gene therapy is 6 times above the untreated lifespan. Most of them live a much better quality of life like you're seeing here. All right, in my last minute, I just want to tell you about what's on the horizon. We are partnering this intracranial approach with a French biotechnology company called Lysogene that has done this for another lysosomal storage disease called Sanfilippo syndrome. Their second indication is going to be GM1 gangliosidosis. I met with them in Boston yesterday. And the firm target date for the human clinical trial is fourth quarter of next year. So we're getting very close to getting all of that taken care of. As I finish up, we also are exploring an intravenous approach. Up until the last 4 or 5 years, there was no way to get gene therapy into the brain across the blood-brain barrier without direct injection. Recently, it's been shown that these vectors can get into the brain if they're a specific subtype after an intravenous injection. So we actually treated some cats by an intravenous injection, actually just a couple. The MRIs look fantastic. This is a normal MRI. Look at the dark area of the white matter here in the brain. In the untreated cat, that dark area of white matter is almost gone. In the treated cat at 2 years of age, that white matter is preserved. Same thing in the cerebellum. This is a video of that treated cat. Let me set this up just a little bit. When we pull them out of the kennels in the afternoons, they're usually sleeping and they don't want to get up and be videotaped. So sometimes we have to stimulate them with a laser pointer. All right. So let's see if Christine is going to pay attention to the laser pointer. Yeah, you'll see it come in, and there she goes, off to the races. And I know from this video you can't really see whether she walks normally or not. And I can promise you that gene therapy does not induce hatred of laser pointers in cats. But here's a little clip showing her walking normally, just to let you know that this IV gene therapy may be the real deal as well. Anyway, that's our hope for the future, much less invasive procedure, and that's where we're going next. Thank you very much for your attention.